At around 8:30, a man entered the Ampol service station wearing a black balaclava and armed with a knife. He threatened the male assistant before escaping on foot with a small sum of money and 40 packs of cigarettes. Meanwhile, police are searching for a man after a hold-up at the Colonial State Bank at Mayfield yesterday afternoon. The man entered the bank at around 4 o'clock and demanded money from staff. It's believed he was carrying a weapon and was wearing a black balaclava. He took a sum of money before escaping in a white late model Falcon stolen from a dry cleaner's earlier. Meanwhile, the Newbold Bowling Club, also at Mayfield, is counting the cost after thieves emptied every poker machine in the place. The robbery looks to be the work of professionals. They took cash from Saturday and Sunday night's takings, a figure estimated in the thousands of dollars. The cigarette machine also fell victim. Simone Cobb, NBN News. Having overlooked the Black Soul Valleys at Cassilis for 150 years, the Ballantyne Shearing Shed stands as a monument to what was once a wool empire in an emerging nation. But the grand old shed had fallen into disrepair when the shearers stopped treading the boards 25 years ago. Handling 100,000 sheep in its prime, the property today no longer runs merinos. Determined to preserve a part of Australia's pioneering heritage, the owners Nick and Sarah Thompson registered the shed with the National Trust and sought funding.
I see it, of course, every day, sometimes 10 times a day, and it was terrible to see this magnificent thing falling down. So it wasn't, there's no personal gain, it was more, I guess you'd say, guilt.
The Thompsons matched a $24,000 grant in time and labour to fix the building's sinking structure. Its cathedral-like architecture is unique in Australia. Called a floating concept, the poles don't go into the ground but sit on cross members instead. The ingenious design can be credited with the shed's durability on the marsh-like black soil.
The use of convicts meant that there wasn't a great worry about if a few got few fell off the top, but of course we don't know. There are no ghosts in the shed, so hopefully it had a clean record.
Not a nail in sight, the structure is kept together with wooden pegs, testimony to carpentry skills rarely seen today. With the majority of the restoration complete, the magic of a bygone era has been returned to a magnificent woolshed. Simone Cobb, NBN News.
After years of lobbying, artists in the Hunter now have a home of their own. And today, young sculptors from St Paul's were making the most of it. Newcastle's first visual arts centre opened its doors to an enthusiastic crowd, and while the Wharf Road workshop is a long way from finished, the local arts community is ecstatic.
A space like this, where you've got a mixture of the commercial aspects of art, but also a number of gallery spaces where you can show the variety, the broad gamut of what art's all about in the one area, can make all the difference.
The $700,000 project includes plans for a mezzanine level, design shop, cafe and several galleries.
It's an interactive community, it's not another gallery. It's for people to come and actually participate, learn and be part of the experience.
The group is on the lookout for someone to manage the centre. Meanwhile, tenders will be announced for other honeysuckle initiatives, a function centre, growers' produce market and a waterfront restaurant. Sarah Griffiths, NBN News.
Council General Manager Robert Gibbons took time off from the stresses of his office to deliver Council's gift to the city. He was joined by Lord Mayor Greg Hees and several hundred other Council staff, planting 14,000 trees and shrubs along Newcastle Road. The idea is to create a green corridor from Wall's End to the city. It's an expensive gift, but one that will make a lasting impression.
And in 10, 20 years' time, the staff and the community will be able to watch this planting grow.
The operation was done completely by hand, creating a record in Australia for the most trees planted in a day. Council workers haven't been known for record outputs in the past. Organisers of this working bee say it's been an exceptional effort.
I know there's the standard joke about council workers, but I'd defy anyone to accuse anyone of being slack today. Everyone's just working very, very, very hard.
Blake Doyle, NBN News.
Energy Australia says the solar power plant will generate 200 kilowatts for 3,000 of its pure energy customers. The corporation expects to be producing environmentally friendly energy within the next couple of years. Singleton Council has already given in-principle approval. Meanwhile, Newcastle University has marked Environment Week with a one-day ban on the city's biggest cause of greenhouse gas, cars. The campus remained a vehicle-free zone to highlight the damage caused by car emissions. And a chance for Newcastle residents to cut their power bills by more than $200 and save the environment at the same time. The state government's Sustainable Energy Development Authority says it'll give householders $20 towards a more energy-efficient showerhead. The program aims to reduce energy use and in turn cut greenhouse gas emissions in the city by 4,000 tonnes within 5 years. People have to apply for the rebate by the end of the month. Richard O'Leary, NBN News.
It's been a horror season of injuries for Andrew Johns. Last night's incident coming on top of another ankle injury earlier this year. Early reports claimed Johns may have broken bones in his lower leg, but those fears have been allayed with news it's only ligament damage.
Sort of the pressure went on and I heard a crack and my first thought was, oh, I've done my ankle again.
Johns hobbled back into Newcastle with his other teammates this afternoon. The half is confident of putting on a night's Guernsey within 2 weeks.
Hopefully I'd like to make the second Origin match, or if I don't make that, definitely the North Sydney game. So I think it's only a matter of, 2 weeks.
Andrew is such an integral part of the side, and we've been without him for so long this season already. He'll be badly missed.
One man's injury is another's fortune. Leo Denever will again prove his potential in the halfback role this weekend.
Throws the onus back onto Leo. He's been playing well and we've got to continue in that vein.
The night's other Origin players, Paul Harrigan, Adam Muir and Robbie O'Davis, have been named for this Sunday's clash with St George at Cogra. Blake Doyle, NBN News.
Thank you. With severe spending cuts and a proposed rate rise, Newcastle Council was poised to bring down a tough but balanced budget. However, the budget has been dealt a savage blow courtesy of the federal government. The annual Commonwealth grant to the council has come in $430,000 under last year's figure.
I think it's appalling that the federal government is not providing incentives to local government. It 2 years in a row now, it has continued to punish local government.
It gives the council two options: increase rates even more than planned, or cut more services from a budget the council says has already been pared down to the bone.
It means that we've got to cut another $436,000 worth of projects or expenditure out of the budget if we're going to maintain the balanced budget as per the draft.
Among the services to be affected, the city's libraries. Although a proposal to close the Hamilton Library has been shelved, it's likely library hours will be cut back. Librarians met today to consider where and how cuts could be made. It's an exercise sure to be repeated by all council managers in the next fortnight. Phil Hind, NBN News. Those who turned up for Ms Hanson's sold-out One Nation launch at Newcastle Civic Theatre were forced to run a gauntlet of thousands of protesters. Some 300 police, including members of the Special Operations Group, are on hand to keep supporters and demonstrators apart. Police occupied every vantage point. As the crowd pressed forward, the corridor created by police narrowed, forcing ticket holders to shoulder their way into the venue. While it was a bit much for one of Ms Hanson's younger supporters, others were unfazed by the taunts.
Pauline Hanson stops. Saviour of Australia. Count on it.
I think she's just coming forth and saying what a lot of people are afraid to say.
Not everyone entering the Civic Theatre, though, were Hanson supporters. The protest was mostly peaceful. Fears the controversial MP's appearance would lead to violence were unfounded.
The rowdy welcome protesters had planned for Ms Hanson herself didn't eventuate. The controversial MP smuggled into the building.
Only one protester was led away. He hasn't been charged. As Ms Hanson spoke inside, the atmosphere outside the Civic Theatre turned festive. Across in nearby Civic Park, a large crowd was also making its protest against Ms Hanson with music and dancing. Organisers of the cultural stomp say they were thrilled by the public response.
And we were happy if we got 10, but we've got like probably about 2,000 or more, we don't know.
While Ms Hanson's appearance didn't produce the fireworks expected, it was a reminder her One Nation party at this stage is creating deep divisions in the community. Newcastle went into the match looking to make amends for the loss to University in the semi-finals of the Hahn Pre-Season Cup. With just 1 point separating the sides late in the first term, University captain David Kelleher booted his side clear. A try to winger Michael Griffin sent the visitors to the break 11 in front. The second half was all Sydney. The giant University pack dominated in the slippery conditions. Two tries in 10 minutes had the visitors out in front by 23 points and looking comfortable. Newcastle may pay a high price for the University visit. State under 21 fly half Brad Dilley had to be helped from the field with what turned out to be a lower back problem. Newcastle's woes didn't end there. Nicholas Perkins crossing to add insult to injury. So at the halfway mark of the season, the Wildfires are now 3 wins for 4 losses. Phil Hind, NBN News. Al Mansour paid more than $20 for the win and $4.20 the place. The trifecta returned a very healthy $1,353.20. Our second Group 1 race was the Qantas Queensland Oaks over 2,400 metres. Crystal Palace paid more than $6 for the win and $2.10 the place, the trifecta $550. Our final event was race 4, the Qantas QTC Cup, over 1,200 metres. Number 5, Celestial Choir, returned punters $6.50 for the win and $1.70 for the place. The trifecta paid more than $130.
Miserable conditions at St John Oval this afternoon, and West made it an even worse day out for Central by flying to a 14-0 half-time lead. A suicidal start by Central Charlestown to the second term, the Butcher Boys dicing with a bit more than what their coach would prefer. From the next set of six, the Rosellas adopted similar hot potato tactics. From one side of the field to the other, West passed the ball through 14 pairs of hands before the overlap finally presented itself, Paul Skovgaard finishing off in the corner for an 18-0 lead. From the sideline, Scott Bradley also excelled. His conversion made it a 20-point ball game. And with that, the home side fired up. Despite the touch judge's report, Jim Bell wasn't sent from the field. Instead, he stayed on to watch West run away with a comprehensive victory.
The Mazda sedan had been travelling north on the Nelson Bay Road when the 76-year-old driver veered to the wrong side and collided with an oncoming car. The 89-year-old female passenger from Anna Bay was killed instantly. The driver, also from Anna Bay, suffered multiple fractures. She is now in a stable condition in the John Hunter Hospital. The 47-year-old male driver in the other car was unharmed. Meanwhile, a lucky escape for a man who wrapped his car around a power pole in Cardiff today. The 23-year-old had been driving along Mile Road when he lost control of his vehicle and slammed into the pole. The pole snapped on impact, bringing down power lines. The driver suffered a broken leg. Police say speed was a factor. Simone Cobb, NBN News.
Final farewells for Hunter, and surprisingly no tears as family and friends wish the Mariners goodbye. Super League's World Club Challenge kicks off this week, Hunter buoyed by that win over Brisbane.
There was a lot of yahoos after Friday night's game, but I think half of the reason was because you pulled through the game uninjured.
Joining the uninjured squad of 20, Kevin Iroh and John Carlaw, both were given the call-up after late clearances on their fitness.
Still a bit of soreness there, but I tried to play.
After the weekend's win, everyone was looking forward to the tour. Staff and management alike rate Friday night as the team's best performance.
It does a lot for your confidence, getting a good win against a good team before you go away, and I think we'll take the pluses from that game over there too, I hope.
Hunter plays three games in the European leg of the challenge, the first on Sunday night.
The reputation of Paris, Castleford and Sheffield is poor at the moment, but we can't underestimate them. But if we can play like we did on Friday night, we can beat anyone.
And on the contract front, Robbie Ross has rejected what has been termed a lucrative offer to stay with the Mariners for the next two seasons.
It's a bit hard at this stage in the year to make a decision, so I just have to wait at the end of the year now and sum it all up then.
The Hunter Street Mall has gone from being a vibrant city centre to a hub of crime. In the last 18 months, the majority of serious CBD offences have occurred in the mall, and police, retailers, shoppers and residents all want it cleaned up.
Everyone tells us through our safety audits and through just general talking with the people that they would feel the mall would be a far safer place and a better place to visit, and therefore encourage trade to the mall if these cameras were put in.
Senior Constable Tony Tamplin says the mall is hard to police because of the many escape routes. He believes at least 12 surveillance cameras will be needed to properly observe the area.
We're looking at the video cameras being a method of not only stopping the crimes from occurring, but if they do occur, identifying the people that committed them.
The scheme could cost around $250,000. Although council has not yet made a commitment, it plans to lobby the state government for funding. Simone Cobb, NBN News.
The launch of the State Netball Championships was going to plan today until the local association launched into Newcastle Council as well. The long-running saga over a new administration and amenities building was the focus of the attack, the association saying it's embarrassed to be holding the titles at National Park.
Unfortunately, all we have at the moment is a patch of dirt, and the State Championships will be conducted under very, very difficult circumstances without a building.
Few will deny the old complex is past its use-by date. Originally built to cater for 300 people, the building now struggles to accommodate more than 3,000 netballers. And with the state titles attracting more than 1,000 participants over the long weekend, the association says it's not good enough.
Nowhere near good enough, not for the city. I'm embarrassed, quite frankly, to have the city not be shown in its best light.
On a brighter note, the championships will showcase the state's best teams and players. 54 districts have nominated for the event, considered a good chance in the under-17s, host Newcastle. A few camera-shy moments at first, but the girls are expected to perform well, so too the Newcastle Open side, captained by Tracy Baggs.
We've got a good mix of experience and youth in the side, so hopefully this year we have got a good chance.
Competition starts with the opening ceremony a match past on Saturday. Jonathan Upton, NBN News. If you like a weekend punt, it's good news. The Newcastle Jockey Club has been successful in its application for an auditorium betting licence. On major race days when there is no meeting in the Newcastle area, bookmakers and tote facilities will operate at Broadmeadow.
What we're offering is the opportunity to compare the totalisator and the bookmaker's prices and make a decision based on that assessment. So we see that as being a definite advantage.
Beaumont Park has accommodated the demand for Saturday and public holiday betting, but with the track closing next month, the auditorium will fill that void.
It has been a worry for us for some time as to exactly what was going to happen after the closure at the end of June, and it's obviously a big kick on for the club to actually have this decision made in our favour.
The NJC plans to have the facility operational for its first Phantom meeting on July 12. Jonathan Upton, NBN News.
The death knell chimed loudly for Bell's restaurant workers in the Hunter yesterday. 150 jobs gone, 5 outlets closed, and a steady stream of anxious suppliers collecting what they say is theirs.
It was sudden. A lot of people didn't expect it. You know, you always hope that, you know, things will get better.
The Bell's Restaurant Group opened 6 weeks ago when entrepreneur Trevor Willoughby paid an estimated $30 million to the struggling Sizzler chain to buy 37 restaurants. But lack of capital for marketing and promotion saw customer figures plunge by up to 50%. Outlets in Newcastle, Broadmeadow, Charlestown, Greenhills and Gosford were among the casualties.
Workers in the Hunter heard the bad news yesterday following an interstate phone hookup between Bell's boss Trevor Willoughby and his restaurant managers.
Some of them took it quite dramatically. It affected some of them. They were very emotional about it because some of these people have been with the company since 1989 as well, it's been their life.
Bell's is now in voluntary administration and searching for another buyer. One company rumoured to be interested is US steakhouse chain Lone Star, which already has stores in Australia. Vanessa Spark, NBN News.